for joining us this evening. May I kindly request everyone to be seated as we will begin our program very soon. Now, another request that I'm going to make is we put all our mobile devices to silent mode to facilitate the smooth running of the program. Thank you, gentlemen, ladies. Right, ladies and gentlemen, announcing the arrival of Ambassador Ong King Yong, Executive Deputy Chairman of RSIS, Dr. Al-Bakri Ahmad, Deputy Chief Executive of Muis, and our distinguished speaker, Professor Ebrahim Moosa. Executive Deputy Chairman of the S. Rajaratnam School of International Studies, Ambassador Ong Keng Yong, Deputy Chief Executive of Muis, Dr. Al-Bakri Ahmad, our eminent speaker, Professor Ebrahim Moosa, distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, I begin with greetings of peace and a very good evening to one and all. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. My name is Faizal Abdullah, and I warmly welcome you to the RSIS Muis Academy Public Lecture of 2016. This public lecture is, of course, jointly organized by the Muis Academy and RSIS. Muis Academy, as you know, is a research and education arm of the Islamic Religious Council of Singapore. The Academy aims at building the thought leadership capabilities of the socio-religious community so as to shape a progressive religious life of the Muslim community. RSIS, of course, is the leading research and graduate teaching institution in strategic and leading and international affairs in the Asia-Pacific. This talk is part of RSIS in seminar series on Muslim societies in Asia, which was launched at the beginning of 2016 with the aim of analyzing the current challenges facing Muslim societies and grounding the debates of reform and transnational movements in Asian contexts. This lecture is testament to the continued partnership by both institutions in many ways as we move towards the goal of being a community of excellence. Without further ado, please join me in welcoming Ambassador Ong, Executive Deputy Chairman of S. Rajaratnam School of International Studies, to give his opening remarks. Ambassador Ong, please.
Thank you, Faizal. Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. First of all, let me thank Muis, in particular Dr. Al-Bakri, Dr. Muhammad Hanan, for facilitating this event tonight. Next, I want to say that my researcher had told me to read this speech. But for those of you who know me, I don't like to read speeches. So all I want to say will be a very short one. First of all, we are very honored to have Dr. Professor Ebrahim Moosa and his lovely wife, Nisa, to join us this evening and to visit Singapore to share his knowledge and let us know how he conducts his research and what he has been doing. I was given his book, What is Madrasa? I am still at chapter 3. And my wife told me to forget about it. Just talk to you personally and get your verbal take on it. So we are happy tonight to listen to Professor Ebrahim Moosa. He has spent a lot of his time researching, studying Islamic traditions, Islamic thought, and trying to make some sense out of this whole area of very difficult studies to educate people like me. So I hope that all of you will have this opportunity to listen to him. Maybe you want to question him, because I'm told by my Muslim colleagues that there is a lot of contestation in the Muslim Islamic world about what is Islamic tradition, how it should be interpreted, and how it should be engaged. So I am not a Muslim, although I spend a lot of my time studying the Middle East and getting in trouble with all my friends in the Middle East. But I will leave it to the professor to give us more of his scholarship. But I'm told by reading his book on the madrasa, I think Professor Ebrahim Moosa like to emphasize the circumstances, the context of all our Muslim societies in the different countries, and the development through the ages and through the years, and to see how Islamic tradition, Islamic thought can be properly construed by us and help us to lead a better life. One important point which my professor from RSIS told me is that all these Islamic values, traditions are all, you know, based on the religion, of course, but it flourishes as an Islamic civilization, and most of us who are not Muslims can glean a lot of wonderful ideas and values from understanding this particular topic. So tonight we're going to have this morality and the public sphere, harnessing Islamic ethics for the common good. I hope in a multi-racial, multi-religious society like Singapore, we can get something useful. And I see many non-Muslim members of the audience, so it will be a good experience for all of us tonight. I think I should stop here, but once again to thank Muis Academy, Muis itself, and all of you for this opportunity to share our ideas and to listen to Professor Ebrahim Moosa to give us his exposition on his scholarship and how he feel about some of these very important subjects. So I will just stop here. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Ambassador Ong. As of course is already highlighted, the topic for tonight's lecture is morality and the public sphere, harnessing Islamic ethics for the common good. Now, the topic will be presented by our distinguished speaker, Professor Ebrahim Moosa, who is also a professor of Islamic studies in Notre Dame University of the United States of America. To introduce the topic and profile of our speaker, I now invite Deputy Director of Capacity Building and Interfaith Engagement and Vice Dean of Muis Academy, Dr. Muhammad Hanan Hassan, as the chairperson for today's lecture. Vice Dean, please.
Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Assalamu alaikum warahmatullahi ta'ala wabarakatuh, and very good evening. Like Ambassador Ong, I too do not like to read speeches. However, my colleagues reminded me to keep to the time, so the paper will guide me in introducing the subject. So allow me to just go through a page or so as introduction to our discussion this evening. In what seems to be a very secularized world, indicators seem to suggest otherwise, that religions are increasingly playing significant role in the public discourse and active partners in shaping public discourse, in shaping public lives. Religions today, particularly Islam, is invariably brought onto the table of discussion and negotiation, or employed to justify certain actions for right or wrong reason. Probably the question today, in light of the current development, is not what role religion can play in the public discourse and public space, but rather, how can religions contribute positively in developing a humane and dignified lives? How can religions offer visionary, creative solutions and ideas towards a more progressive understanding of religious life in the modern world? One that focuses on higher principles in deeper meanings of life beyond rules, regulations, and set of laws. All religions promote the cultivation of virtues for harmonious societies, and we draw inspirations from religious sources in defining public morality with the aim to provide solutions to current societal challenges. Muslims have been drawing inspirations from their Islamic traditions and are engaging with new methodologies to interpret them in their increasingly plural and diverse societies. In this seminar, we wish to focus on Islamic enduring ethics and legacy, proposing a revival of Islamic thought and knowledge, just as Abu Hamid al-Ghazali did in his book, Ihya Ulumuddin. We hope to be able to emphasize the importance of critical and creative engagement with Islamic traditions, necessary in offering visionary solutions, a theology of human dignity, a way of life that puts human dignity at its very core, and in bringing back human sanity. If you ask Professor Ebrahim, he would say that we have lost our sanity. Additionally, to highlight ways in which these practical ethics can contribute to the common space of the pluralistic global society. Ladies and gentlemen, there is no better person to talk on such thought-provoking subject from a provocative scholar. I've known him for a couple of years, and you will share my assessment how provocative Pak Ibrahim can be, but in a positive sense. Yeah, in the positive sense. He has written and spoken a lot on such a topic. Ambassador Ong has introduced him. I do not wish to sort of repeat what has been said, but I wish to just indicate that Professor Ebrahim is a fusion of traditional and contemporary modern sciences, hailed from a very traditional institutions like Deoband and Darul Uloom in India, coupled with modern science. I think he's one of the best person to talk on this topic in talking about Islamic traditions. He has written an award-winning book. I think you ought to get this book and read it. This book, Ghazali and the Poetics of Imagination. This book has won an award as a best first book in the history of religions by the American Academy of Religion. And please join me now in welcoming Professor Ebrahim to enlighten us on this very important topic, morality and the public space. Oh, please.
Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Alhamdulillah rabbil alameen. As-salatu was-salamu ala ashraf al-anbiya ibn al-mursaleen, Sayyidina Muhammad wa ala ali wa sahabi ajma'in. Good evening. We send salutations and blessings on our Prophet Muhammad. And I want to thank you all for coming here this evening, taking out from your busy time on a Friday evening, on a rainy evening. Let me also thank Ambassador Ong Keng Yong for his warm welcome and for the collaboration of the RSIS and the Muis Academy, Dr. Hannan, and his colleagues in the last couple of days has been, and on previous occasions, have been really warm hosts. I've learned a great deal about the developments of Muis's leadership in developing thought and ideas for the community of Singapore. I've also learned a great deal about how people in Singapore are dealing with a number of challenging issues. So I've learned a great deal, and I go away from here with positive impressions about your community. And I also believe that you have a lot to offer. Tonight I want to talk about morality and the public sphere. And if we talk about morality and the public sphere in a Islamic context, you're talking about something like this. You're talking about a conversation, which you call discourse, that happens across various parts of the world. There you see a map of a 2014 Muslim population map. There are people there from North Africa, people from Sub-Saharan Africa, people from East Asia. You're seeing people in different parts of the Middle East where there's intense green. And then you see the dispersion of Muslim communities in Europe. In France, for instance, where Muslims are above 10% of the population. Germany, significant numbers, but also in parts of Central Asia and further on. So to actually talk about Islam and public morality, we're talking about very, very different contexts. And obviously, what I'm going to share with you is going to be materials and issues and topics that I have dealt with, and I will speak mostly from a South African context, South Africa, where I was born and raised, my experience of studying in India, and then working as a journalist in Europe, and then now, for the last 17 years, I'm in the United States at different American universities. And it's from that context that I will share with you information. So Islam is a community of discourse. In other words, what we mean by that is a community of conversation. And these conversations are marked by the conditions under which Muslims live. And therefore, we should not be surprised if you look at some of the contexts in which Muslims are living. They are living in very, very peaceful, stable societies in some places. And other parts of the world, they're living in very unstable conditions. They're living in places where they are failed states. And failed states produce certain conditions under which decent human beings get dehumanized. And so we have this entire spectrum of from stable to unstable, good states to failed states. And it's within those contexts that Islam and Islamic discourses are developed. When you talk about Islam as a community of, and Muslims as a community of discourse, we're talking about everything that Muslims might be doing, from their written practices, from their gestures, from their behaviors, from their writings, from the cultural backgrounds from which they come. And so when we talk about this, we're talking about multiple interpreters, multiple communities, and multiple audiences. And these become the people with whom you're going to be encountering. So I think just to share some of the more elementary elements for those of you who might not be familiar with Islam's key categories, and for those of you who already know, I apologize for the repetition. When you think about morality in Islam, the first word that strikes you is the word Sharia. And Sharia is basically those norms that are given through the revelation of the Prophet Muhammad or through the Prophet's own practice. But it doesn't only stop there. Sharia and the interpretation of the Sharia is also the construction of human beings over the centuries, mostly men, and now increasingly more and more women are joining that campaign to understand what Sharia is. So when we talk about Sharia, we're talking about in an amalgam what we today talk about, moral and ethical norms that are divinely inspired. They're divinely inspired, but understood by human beings. And literally, Sharia means exactly what you're seeing there. It is a watering place. Literally is the path to water. And in just as significant as water is to human existence, in the same way, norms are important for the flourishing of human society. Society require norms. They require certain kind of values to make them flourish. And therefore, the imagery of water and the imagery of a nourishing place is so important. Now, the whole question about, you know, how Sharia has developed and how Sharia, you know, develops over time, it's a long story. One of the ways in which people today increasingly interpret Islamic morality is to think about Sharia as a set of ethical objectives. And that is what we call the purpose-oriented understanding of Sharia. In other words, Sharia would be viewed as the preservation of religion or faith, the preservation of life, preservation of intellect, preservation of property, and the preservation of family. So oftentimes people think of Sharia as Islamic law, and I always have to work very hard to tell people, don't use the word Islamic law. Because Islamic law is basically the way in which when colonizers came to the Muslim world, they saw Muslims are engaging in certain kind of norms, and they said, okay, they have a qadi, they have a judge who's giving out, handing out instructions, giving decisions, so that must be law. Yes, the qadi does hand down some kind of rules and regulations, but the qadi is largely someone appointed by the state. And so in that sense, when someone is appointed by the state and that person enforces rules and regulations, those rules and regulations do have the force of law. So it is a kind of law. But all of Sharia is not law. Only a small segment of Sharia is enforced by the state. So for instance, rules and regulations regarding capital crimes, or enforcement of marriages and divorces or inheritance matters require some kind of state authority. In that sense, it is law. But the obligation to fast, and if you're going to fast or decide not to fast, or pray, or do the moral good, there is no enforcement, but the human beings themselves, individuals, have to be the agents to enforce that. So what many of the things that we talk about as Islamic law, as it is, you know, handed down from the divine, it is divinely inspired, but human labor constructs it and develops it. Now, this understanding of morality in Islam, this is known as the maqasid of Sharia. But we also have other versions of that, and just to emphasize that the key element within Sharia historically and continues to be today is the whole idea of the centrality of justice. This is important. The Topkapi Palace, that some of you who might have visited Istanbul has been much in the news since last week, and the last week of Ramadan, and then for other reasons too, serious violent acts, and then also an attempted coup. But that tower you see that there is known as the Tower of Justice. That's historically that Muslims do see that Sharia has somewhere at its core the idea of justice. Another example is the scales of justice at the Red Fort. One of the windows of the Red Fort in New Delhi, a Mughal piece of architecture, has there the scales of justice. And again, to show that the emblems of justice are inherent in Muslim culture and civilization. And I'm also emphasizing the idea of material culture in which the manifestation and representation of art and architecture is so crucial. And I hope to, if I don't touch upon it in my lecture, I hope you're going to ask me questions about that. Because I believe that art and architecture is the material culture, the representation of certain forms of aesthetics and beauty that is part of the Islamic tradition, but largely lost out today. When we talk about morality in Islam, what is or isn't morality depends on how we frame what is knowledge. This is a very big word we use, epistemology. Epistemology is basically, literally means a theory of knowledge. But any kind of moral tradition, whether it is divinely inspired or secularly inspired, whatever form of inspiration it may be, it has to grow within a knowledge environment. It requires a certain kind of information and things by which we attach ourselves to it. And knowledge changes over time. Information changes over time. Certain kinds of contexts alter what we consider to be knowledge. So knowledge develops and knowledge grows, and we become beneficiaries of knowledge of the past, but we ourselves, because of our experience also becomes part of knowledge. And one of the great challenges Muslims face today is that oftentimes the questions of morals and values are anchored in practices that are no longer part of your lived experience. And one of the biggest challenges among the many is that how do Muslims create a knowledge tradition that they can own that also reflects their lived experience so that the moral and ethical values are representative of the world in which they are living and not the world that has already passed. And neither should it be so futuristic that you also can't live in it. And so this is the question about epistemology. And often people talk about, you know, how do you figure out epistemology? It's obviously the question of the chicken and the egg, which came first, right? And therefore, that person deep in truth there is worried about, you know, what came first, the chicken or the egg. in terms of knowledge. But you know, you need the chicken and the egg, and whichever came first, you can figure out that later. But really, you need to have some kind of ingredient, and you need to be able to work with that, because that's how, and it requires then thinking. So in order to develop knowledge, you need to think. Whether you struggle with the thinking, whether you figured it out, whether it's the chicken first or the egg first, doesn't matter. The requirement is thinking. Now, what is moral? What is justice? What is the good life? What is the common good? I would argue that what is the common good depends on time and place. The common good of 7th century Arabia might in abstraction be similar to the, in abstraction, be similar to what we have in Singapore today, or in America, or in Pakistan, in abstraction. So it's a question of how morals are constructed and in conditions. So now I've told you something about the ethical approach to Sharia. And when I put up there the 5 purposes of Sharia. But that's not the only game in town. That's not the only way in which people imagine Sharia. The more dominant understanding of Sharia is to think of Sharia as a detailed canon. In other words, it is something of an understanding when I say that sometimes people think of Sharia as a telephone directory. A telephone directory that is very thick, very big, lots of details. Now think of hundreds of telephone directories. Okay, and that's where all the detail lies. And that's where what many, many scholars over time, over the centuries, had elaborated for their time and for their place, certain kinds of interpretations of Sharia that becomes quite big and quite large. Oftentimes, the challenge for modern Muslims, and they often look in terms of very, very learned books and detailed tomes, and you see that these have very fresh covers and they have been newly printed, that these are very classical and books, old 500-600 years, 700 years, 900 years old books that still have currency. Those books are what I refer to as telephone directories. As you know, a telephone directory is usable for a year or sometimes less because people move, then you have to get the new telephone directory, you have to update it. And therefore people wrote lots and lots of books because they keep on updating the canon. They keep on interpreting it new for every new, for every generation. And different people in different parts of the world also interpreted it differently. And so in Islamic tradition, there were multiple schools of thought that made it possible for people to interpret what Islam meant and what Islamic values and morality meant at particular time and place. The question is that oftentimes Muslims in the present feel so beholden to those books of the past that they cannot move beyond those contributions to understanding what the tradition in the present should look like. In other words, we are caught up in a backward-looking mode, whereas every generation from those authors kept on updating their telephone directory. So they had updated telephone directories. The problem is that today you have to update the telephone directory in very different ways. You might not even need a telephone directory. You go to Google if you want to have an answer of you know, what someone's telephone number is. And people nowadays go to Google for all the answers too. But what I'm trying to say is that you need a different way of understanding the past in order to make the present a meaningful one, where the lived experience of Muslims today can also be part of their tradition. So it's not to entirely forget about this enormous and very valuable tradition, not to forget about it, but you have to make use of the usable parts of that tradition that's going to be part of the continuity, and there are going to be certain things that are discontinuous. The question of slavery is part of discontinuity. The understanding of society as patriarchal is increasingly becoming something that Muslims no longer aspire to. And a whole range of other kinds of practices that are already discontinued. What continues are those fundamental foundational teachings of Islam that got to do with salvation, what we call the 5 pillars. Those do not change. So the idea that one has a declaration of faith in God as one, and the Prophet Muhammad as his messenger, the obligation to pray five times a day, the obligation to fast in the month of Ramadan, the obligation to give zakat, and the obligation to go for pilgrimage, those become the core tenets that hold Islamic communities together. But Muslims have over time held on to those, but they would disagree of how they do business. They would disagree about what kind of political system they would implement. They would disagree about, financial practices. One school of law would say this, another school of law would say something else. They might not disagree on what is forbidden in business, but they would have different ways of interpreting everything subsidiary to that. So that is one of the big challenges that we have today, is that we have to think about Sharia in a different way. And therefore, I'm saying that one should think about Sharia as a Taj Mahal, as something, as a very beautiful piece of architecture, in which those five principles, those five purposes that I listed earlier, become the kind of key manifestation of it. And so Sharia as a Taj Mahal, as an aesthetic objective that gives you the ethical outcomes. But as you know, that the Taj Mahal, like the telephone directory, the Taj Mahal is also something that has been constructed. And so what the big challenge is for Muslims today is to find the wiring within the Taj Mahal, if there is wiring. Of course, the Taj Mahal was built before there was electricity. But think about the Taj Mahal as the internal kind of structures of the Taj Mahal, and how we can connect it to the telephone directories and the canonical tradition to find the live wires, the real and the usable live wires within the canon, within the canonical tradition. That it becomes very, very important to make that kind of connection between the purpose-orientated Sharia and that very detailed understanding of Sharia. Now, this very detailed orientation of the Sharia, this detailed canonical interpretation of the Sharia, is the going currency in many, many Muslim jurisdictions. This idea of Sharia being purpose-oriented is often used as a slogan, as a feel-good narrative, but doesn't always become the centerpiece of when fatwas are issued, when rulings are issued, when detailed discussions about very significant issues in Muslim life is being debated. Those do not feature. Only a small minority of people market and talk about that, but oftentimes people are still beholden by the detailed tradition. And that detailed tradition is very much culture-laden. It is laden with the history and the time of the past, and hence, many of those scholars who are trained in that tradition often have a great difficulty in connecting with the Taj Mahal version. And therefore, the labor ahead and the challenge ahead for Muslim scholars remains that how do you create a usable and a mobile set of principles and rules drawn from the classical tradition, but that can also give foundation to the Taj Mahal. Because ultimately, you want this Taj Mahal, it cannot just be five objectives, but it must become more expansive, it must have details, it must be able to stand on its own legs, just as those classical textbooks and those classical books can stand because they got deep foundations. So it's a question of how to create foundations without breaking with the past. Muhammad Iqbal, the great pre-partition Indian thinker, talked about that the challenge before modern Muslims is to at once reinterpret Islam entirely without breaking with the past. Reinterpreting Islam entirely without breaking with the past. That is a huge challenge. And I think in the area of law and morality, morality and ethics in particular, this is entirely doable in a very interesting way, provided we invest the resources and the goods in order to make this possible. How to understand the common good? The common good is easily derived when you have this ethical orientation of the Sharia, a Sharia that thinks about that the preservation of religion, life, the question of intellect, property, and family. You can make that list longer because it's so goal-oriented. You have in front of you a slide by a very prominent Muslim thinker, Yusuf al-Qaradawi, who talks about maslaha, which is the Arabic word for interest or public interest or the good, what we would call the public good. And therefore, the public good in Islam precisely get captured by those five objectives, but you can also make another list as long as you can justify it is a public good or common good. And this is precisely where the work is being done. And therefore, it's so easy for people like Qaradawi who has signed on. Qaradawi has signed on to the purpose or the goal-oriented interpretation of the Sharia. He signed on to that. Even though he also knows a great deal about the classical tradition, he's largely, you know, hovering between the two. So for him, it's very easy to talk about this is the public interest and Sharia has certain kind of public interest. Not all traditional scholars will be able to do that as easily as Qaradawi does. For many of them, they will think about this as a very controversial statement. So I can show you jurisdictions in Indonesia or India or other parts of the Middle East where they will be saying, well, we have to be a bit skeptical about this maslaha oriented because there are detailed rules and regulations already written that has to be implemented in their detail. But when you tell them that those details and those environments and those circumstances are no longer available, then, you know, they would say, well, you just have to implement it. So it then becomes a very, very, or almost kind of a Disney-esque understanding of what Islamic ethics is, because you're talking about languages that people cannot understand. Often it becomes, you know, fantasy or something else. Now, in advancing the common good, and remember the first slide I put up, and I told you about this vast environment of Muslim discourse. And I told you that in some places Muslim societies are stable, and other places are unstable. One of the key issues that Muslims face in different parts of the world is the question of governance. If you have governance, you can promote the common good. But when you have a failure in governance, everything else falls apart. You must remember that historically Muslims thought that one night without proper governance is worse than 100 years of tyranny. One night without governance where there's chaos, one night is worse than 100 years of oppression because they valued stability. Now, we don't want oppression, but that is just a metaphor of talking about instability, because in one night of instability and lack of governance, you can lose everything. You can lose everything. The entire country can be depleted. So the key issue is the question of governance and getting good governance going. It doesn't have to be liberal democracy. It can be other forms of democracy. It can be other forms of governance. But what you require is good governance. You cannot advance neither morality nor public good if you don't have a stable environment and you don't have good governance. Jamaluddin al-Afghani was an important figure of the Islamic Renaissance and the Islamic revival in the late 19th and 20th century. He created a team of people that worked with him, among them Sheikh Muhammad Abdu, who became a very prominent scholar in Egypt, and also Rashid Rida, who was a student of Muhammad Abdu. And these individuals have been influential around the world, including in this part of the world. Afghani always pointed out that the challenge of Muslims in the late 19th century has been external colonization and internal despotism. That was his analysis. External colonization, internal despotism, that was his analysis. A man who did not see Afghani, because Afghani died and he joined the team quite late. But a young lawyer from Aleppo was a man by the name of Abdurrahman al-Kawakibi. Kawakibi actually even died younger, and he died even before Muhammad Abdu. He joined the team. And Kawakibi wrote a very, very important book in which he argued and talked about the importance of how to defeat despotism. And he believed that despotism and subjugation are antithetical to Islam. And the one area that he pointed out that why despotism succeeded is because they took control of education and knowledge. and knowledge production. And therefore, when this knowledge production is distorted by the objective of despotism, everything goes wrong, and therefore everything gets altered as a result, and he made a detailed analysis of that. When he was thinking of despotism, he was thinking mostly about Ottoman despotism. He felt that the Ottomans were really pushing people of Syria, where he was, where he lived, put them backwards and did not make them go forward in their lives. But this has also continued in the 20th century, where we had the reign of despots of people like Saddam Hussein, Bin Ali, and Mubarak. I mean, authoritarianism, or that you might call. But you see, I mean, the question of authority, if there is a certain kind of accountability, then it becomes helpful. But if you only have people who treat countries as their fiefdom, when there's corruption, when there's all kinds of things, that's where situation then deteriorates. And all these people started off with good intentions, but slowly and gradually, the lack of accountability resulted in them becoming some of the worst despots the region had seen. And with the result that when external factors come in to correct the situation, so Saddam Hussein's actions against Kuwait and first against Iran, then against Kuwait, and then becomes the mortal enemy of the United States, and then the invasion under George Bush, unjustified, of course, invasion of Iraq. But because of those historical conditions, but also the subjugation of Shias in Iraq under Saddam Hussein, created a strong Shiite opposition in exile that mobilized the international opinion against Saddam Hussein, largely Shiite exiles, with the result that today Iraq is so unstable that it also destabilized the entire region. So despotism might seem attractive for some time, and for those people who are beneficiaries of that, but over time, it can have deleterious effects on the lives of millions of people. And so therefore, it is so crucial that societies have a public sphere, that vibrant societies always have a public sphere. And public spheres differ from one place to the other. But in a public sphere, people talk about, who am I? What is my place? How do I organize myself in this public sphere? And what is my opinion? What do I contribute? How do I shape the public? So you have the newspapers, you have magazines, we have conversations, people write, people have discussions. Those are the things that we talk about, the public sphere. But also you can also have religious communities, different kinds of communities, different kinds of organizations participating in that. And so that is the social space that is separate from the state, the economy and the family, according to Jürgen Habermas, who has been a major kind of spokesperson in articulating what the public sphere is, in which individuals engage each other as private citizens to understand what the common good is. And so this is so important, and this is something that vibrant societies continuously engage in and talk about on a daily basis and improve themselves. And in Islamic thought, for instance, this idea can be also marked by notions of consultation and shura, the question, the idea, the motivation to do the good, the amr bil ma'ruf, the commandment to the good, and forbidding that which is evil. And that has been part of the Muslim tradition for a great deal, for a long time, but it also had a different kind of manifestation in different times. Just for example, when the uprising happens against Mubarak in Egypt, the uprisings are peaceful. It's about, we think that you had your chance to govern. It's time for you to go. They were peaceful. Now, historically, and under no circumstances do any government even today allow people to violently turn against them. Once you use violence, you lose the battle. So violence is strictly prohibited in Islam against political authority. You turn the sword or the gun on political authority, you are sure to be dead. That's something intolerable, it's seen as rebellion, and so on. But through the public sphere, you can give counsel to political rulers. It's called nasiha, it's called advice. And if you go out in the streets and you give advice as the people in Egypt did, and told the rulers. The rulers' obligation should have been, okay, I'm going to introduce these kinds of changes immediately, or I'm stepping down, I'm doing the following thing. You hold out, you put the police onto and the army onto those people, you kill them, you then create turmoil. And so in people do not understand that commanding the good and forbidding the evil is a responsibility of every individual. It's part of how individuals can enter the public sphere, but it must be done in a peaceful manner. Once it loses that peaceful component, it turns into rebellion and you lose your objectives. And whenever things have been peaceful, you had better dividends than when things have been not peaceful. Now today we have different, and unfortunately, some of the religious clerics in Egypt did not understand that. And until the last minute, they were still supporting Mubarak and not coming to the side of the masses who wanted a change and transformation after 30 years or more of misrule by a very elite group of people in Egypt. And that also applies in other places. But in other places, of course, peaceful protesters had been decimated by gunfire, and other places they have been quashed. There's the public sphere, the new public sphere, obviously today is no longer through pamphlets and soapboxes and people talking and so on, but the internet has become very vital means of that. Instagram, Facebook, people discussing, people exchanging views, and people mobilizing through cyber technology and understanding and communicating with each other. And that's what happened in the Arab Spring. Or last weekend we saw, that President Erdogan, from his holiday resort, was using his iPhone, which makes it into the pocket sphere. So he's no longer, today we actually can be very, very effective with this piece of technology and communicate with millions of people as he did, and very influential people do that all the time. People tweet and send out messages and influence people all the time. And so now we have the pocket sphere. Or we saw this as people were thanking Facebook after the Arab Spring, merci to the, thanks to the people, thanks to Facebook. Or people are talking here about the pocket sphere and thanking Facebook for making certain things possible. Now, the question about this is the common good and the public sphere, how to make this possible. But what is going to be the core message? What is the messaging? So you have the public sphere, you have the technology. You have all those kinds of things, and you're talking about, you must have conversation. But what are you going to talk about? What should be the core messaging of our discussions in the public sphere? For me, and given just the state of the world, and not only Muslim societies, but the world, I believe that the fundamental teaching of Islam is about human dignity. And the affirmation of human dignity is at the center for the creation of the human being in Islam. And it's but at the creation of the human being that the Quran very, very explicitly says, وَلَقَدْ كَرَّمْنَا بَنِي Adam, that you confer dignity on the children of Adam. وَحَمَلْنَاهُ عَلَى الْبَرِّ وَالْبَحْرِ وَرَزَقْنَاهُمْ مِنَ الطَّيِّبَاتِ وَفَضَّلْنَاهُمْ عَلَى كَثِيرٍ مِمَّنْ خَلَقْنَا تَفْضِيلًا. There you see the translation. But this should be the cri de coeur, the cry from the heart of every Muslim, of every human being, that it is human dignity that's at the core. Everything we do, from building societies, from building stable societies, for creating technologies, for building homes, for giving people shelter, to working hard and labor to bring food on the table, to enable human flourishing, all that is in order to celebrate the human being and the dignity of the human being. Ibn Arabi, a great Muslim mystic of the 14th century, sang beautifully when he said, فَأَيْنَ مَقَامُ الْبَيْتِ مِنْ قَدْرِ إِنْسَانِ. He looks at the Kaaba and he says, no matter of the great blessing and the sacred environment of the Kaaba, the point of orientation that Muslims pray towards Mecca and this house that Abraham and his son Ishmael built, and that becomes the Muslim center point of their prayers and their worship and their orientation and their pilgrimage. Ibn Arabi says, فَأَيْنَ مَقَامُ الْبَيْتِ مِنْ قَدْرِ إِنْسَانِ. How can you ever compare that sacred place to the value of a human being? value of a human being exceeds everything, exceeds even a sacred space. Because that sacred space is there for the celebration of the human being. When Abraham succeeded in his test, when he was commanded to sacrifice his son, and he shows preparedness and God replaces and say, it is compassion for you, you don't have to do that. And that becomes a sacred space where we celebrate Abraham's loyalty and his dedication to the divine. Despite that sacredness is about the human being and the value of the human being. Without this human being, that sacred space has very little relevance. It's just another space. It's a human being that makes it. And therefore, we have to think about human dignity. And it is astounding. It is astounding that in this verse of the Quran, it gives you three pointers to how you can advance human dignity. On the one hand, it says that we have taken human beings on oceans and on land. That is just to show you two kinds of habitats that human beings have. Today we can even make it in the skies and we can make it elsewhere in a variety of places. We might possibly be able to build habitats on the moon or on Mars in a couple of centuries or decades, I believe, or so the optimism is. But whatever the case may be, to make the land and the sea is basically to indicate the possibilities of human flourishing. And human flourishing and human development is crucial to human dignity. Without development, without industrial development, technological development, social development, cultural development, without that, the human being cannot be nourished. So what we call human development in its broadest sense is absolutely crucial to human dignity. The other part where the verse talks about that we have given human beings, رَزَقْنَاهُ مِنَ الطَّيِّبَاتِ, that we have provided for them of the good things. Every conceivable thing that is good is good. So the Quran makes it extremely, broad and non-specific. Non-specific for the reason that human beings can access these things. And so the Quran doesn't tell you X, Y, and Z is good. You figure it out what is good. The Quran says good. If you figure out it's good, it is good. And human beings will arrive at that kind of. The Quran puts a lot of trust in human beings' ability to discover the good. It does not detail all the good for you. It gives you a few goods. But the rest of the good is something you have to figure it out. So it's not a faith that makes you into an infantile. It doesn't encourage that you to remain in a state of infancy all the time, but requires a certain kind of moral and intellectual maturity and social maturity. And the third aspect of this verse is that it talks about you giving you the capacity to excel. To excel in every possible way. So when you excel, when you discover the good, and when you find places to flourish, you are fulfilling the very core message of human dignity. And this is what's so important, that human dignity is one of the interests of Steven Pinker, a language psychologist, talks about is the one of the interests of the person alongside bodily integrity, personal property, that other people are obligated to respect. Your self-worth. Human dignity, the way we measure it, is self-worth and honor. Sometimes we think of honor in a very negative way, so people kill their sisters because they feel their family honor has been. That's a wrong form of honor. That is honor used in a wrong sense, that to kill people in the name of some kind of honor. That is not honor. That is some perversion. So human dignity at the core, and the crucial issue is that we think of human dignity as something that is innate to us. One part of human dignity is innate, but the other component of human dignity is what you need to create the conditions for human dignity to flourish, and so other people can recognize it. In my analysis, and some of the problems that we are facing in different parts of the Muslim world, but also I think in a country like America, is also what I could call a deficit of dignity. A deficit of dignity, the poverty of dignity. That people who are extremely wealthy and come from good homes still feel that they are not worth anything. or they lack self-worth, that people are not respecting them. And because of that lack of self-respect, they do horrendous acts in order to demonstrate that they have some kind of macho-ness and that they have some kind of authority and that that will give them. So you know this already. Someone like Osama bin Laden, someone who was a millionaire or even richer. And therefore, in a recent interview that I'd given to a Bangladeshi newspaper, I've talked at length about these rich elite Muslims are the biggest challenge because they have the best qualifications, they have a great deal of knowledge and qualifications of in a worldly sense, but they do not have fulfillment. They don't find dignity, because if they found dignity, they will not be able to do the horrendous act that they do. And an experience-based ethics, as I talked about earlier, an ethics based on experience, and a morality which is inherent in Islam, if that is deployed, if that kind of morality is deployed, then that could be the antidote to radicalism. And one of the areas in which we have to really work in order to fulfill that is in the area of education and the reform of education. And not only education in, so human dignity education should happen in all schools from K to 12, but also in universities, in our mosques, and in every public space. We should not allow for any kind of teaching that comes off Islamic institutions. It must be tested at the level of human dignity. Does this further human dignity, or does it detract from human dignity? And we should remember that we are required to be actors and not spectators. If you want to reverse the deficit of dignity, remember this verse of the Quran that says, that recall that if there is going to be a catastrophe because of the wrongdoing of a few, it's not only going to affect the wrongdoers, but it's going to affect the entire community. وَاتَّقُوا فِتْنَةً لَا تُصِيبَنَّ الَّذِينَ ظَلَمُوا مِنْكُمْ خَاسَّةً. It's not going to affect the wrongdoers, because the wrongdoers are going to bring down the entire ship. If you allow someone at the bottom of a ship to dig a hole, the whole ship is going to go down. And these, there are tremendous amount of pathologies that are arising out of the deficit of dignity. One of the things I talk a great deal about, and I've got 3 minutes left, so I'll leave it for question time and you can ask me. Part of the pathology is also that people do not have intelligent diagnosis of problems and engage in tremendous amount of conspiracy theories. So when you cannot diagnose the problem, and everything is a production of Israel and America and the CIA, how are you going to know anything that is happening? I mean, they must be extremely powerful. And if I was Israel and America, I would be extremely proud that I can control the entire world like this. But of course, this is the thinking of the powerless and constructing and these kinds of notions of conspiracy theories that are hugely detrimental. It is injurious to your own self-worth. But you defame others. You think others do not defame you and think about you in that way? You think that you can just throw out defamation to other people, that it will not boomerang on you? This is the lack of intelligence that we find in different places. In order to make human flourishing possible, I believe that we have to take seriously the UN's sustainable development goals. Each one of those goals should be part of our curriculum to understand how human flourishing takes place. Each one of them can be backed up with Islamic teachings of values. Each one of those are to provide water, gender equality. There are 17 of those. Those should be the important things in our lives. I can't go into detail. But I think that curricula and syllabi in schools and universities and so on should be doing this kind of work. And also how to internalize this and how to develop excellence, how to develop habits. Habits, what is ethics? Ethics is about developing certain kind of habits. That's what ethics is all about. It's about certain kind of practices. And these practices need to be internalized. In Muslim societies, there's lots of work going on. And despite this depressing environment that we get from different parts of the world, because of the news and because it's globalized, one gets depressed and thinking the whole of the Muslim world is awash in terrorism. That's not true. There are people doing good work every day, getting up and taking care of their families, giving money in charity, doing work of relief work. The AD Foundation in a place like Pakistan does global work. There are people that are engaged in, you know, groups like Islamic Relief is now become one of the most powerful relief agencies in the world. And you will find people here in your own community doing enormous amount of work, using their wealth, their talent, their ability, their time, in order to make human beings, make the world a better place. You know, we see another place in Tehran, how people are doing certain kinds of work in order to use art and architecture. And one of the things I'm insisting on art is that you must have artistic features in your environment that are beautiful. The external environment influences the internal environment. And therefore, we talk about that the basis of maslaha, public interest, or the basis of this purposeful interpretation of the Sharia. The 14th century thinker by the name of, 13th century thinker by the name of Izzuddin ibn Abdissalam al-Sulami. Izzuddin pointed out that all these things, talking about the ethical outcomes of the Sharia, the public good in the Sharia, all of its basis is in the idea in Islam called Ihsan. Ihsan means excellence. But Ihsan is also the root word HSN, which means beauty. So whatever is excellent must be beautiful. And if it's not beautiful, then it is not properly applied. And therefore, Ihsan is about creating beautiful environments, trees and gardens and architecture, that human beings can experience beauty, and that that external beauty can also work on the internal side of our human existence. And therefore, human flourishing also means that sometimes when people are baiting you and calling you a terrorist, that you could respond to that in a nonviolent way, and show them that peace is more important. I'm going to skip this and just come to some of the remedies. And in summation, these are the things that I think we should do. We should be focusing on ethics, and the Prophet's message in Islam is ethics. Innama bu'ithtu li'utammima makarim al-akhlaq. The Prophet Muhammad says, "I have been dispatched to engage in the completion of moral character." When Aisha was asked, "Can you summarize Muhammad's practice in one line?" She says, "Wakana khulukuhu al-Quran." His character was based on the Quran. And so the idea is ethics. But it's interesting that the Prophet says, "I've been sent to fulfill and to complete the ethical." In other words, the Prophet assumes that there's already ethical practices in communities. All he has to do is to lead it to its completion. And so every community has ethical material within it. You don't have to go get ethical material from Mars. You don't need Ghazali to tell you what it is, or Ibn Rushd or some big name Muslim thinker to tell you. That might be a beacon, but you don't need anybody to tell you. You know what is good, you know what is intuitively good, you know what is ethically right. Otherwise, oftentimes, you're going to go to Ghazali or Ibn Rushd or any past thinker of the past. They're going to take you to their cultural world with their specifics, and it might not be the right ethical remedy that you are looking for. No teaching can be tolerated, or no practice can be tolerated, that violates human dignity. You should be instructing your fatwa committees everywhere in the world that no fatwa should be issued that violates human dignity. So all kinds of crazy fatwas come out that make the front pages of the New York Times, highly embarrassing stuff, highly embarrassing things that really make Muslims look as if they have never pondered these issues, but comes out of fatwa committees in India and Egypt and Syria and other places that are detrimental to Muslim, you know, dignity, but also to Muslim pride. And therefore, one should be making that to be a yardstick. Diagnosis should be rational, not conspiratorial. And dignity of others is just as important. I say that the way you begin to build your own dignity is the way you talk about how you talk about your neighbors on your dinner table. If you talk about your neighbors as the Jew, the Hindu, the Chinese, the kafir, that's the beginning. When you see at age 23 or 24, that kid who you went to a good school at Monash University from Bangladesh in neighboring Malaysia, turns out to be a terrorist. If you do the biographical studies, you will see that oftentimes in the domestic environment, this kind of dehumanizing activities take place. We mock about it, we joke about it, and so on, but it's dehumanizing and becomes very easy from that to become a victim of bad people encouraging you to do evil. And so to defame people on the basis of their race or their religion is contrary to human dignity. And the crucial issue is the upgrading of literacy of the public itself on ethical issues on the basis of dignity, but also Muslim theologians should be also taking this very, very seriously, upgrade the literacy. Today, one of the biggest challenges in all over the Muslim world, and one of the good news here is that your religious leadership, the Muis Academy and other people recognize that these deficits have to be corrected. And so they are trying very hard to expand the knowledge base of Muslim clerics and Muslim theologians. They understand the world, and the teachings and the advocacy that they will do will be in the world in which they are living and not of another world of the past. And so therefore, the upgrading of the literacy of Muslim theologians broadly is crucial, but also, as I already pointed out, the need for the humanities. The study of the humanities humanizes us. The study of, oftentimes we study poetry of Rumi, but we quote Rumi just in order to quote Rumi, or we study al-Mutanabbi, classical thinkers of the Muslim past. But we need to pause on the page of Mutanabbi and think with Mutanabbi how Mutanabbi talks about beauty, how Mutanabbi talks about friendship, how Rumi gives us wisdom, how Ibn Arabi, how we can utilize that wisdom today, that we can begin to find that in the humanities tradition, we are also represented, our past is also represented. Then you become part of a system that you don't think that, okay, I'm only reading Dante, and who is Dante, and I really don't like him. But you can then see the comparison between Dante and other thinkers, and the beauty that people over different times and different civilizations, people who have written and talked about the Bhagavad Gita and variety of traditions, they all talk about similar kinds of goods. And you build that society, and therefore the study of the humanities and architecture is so important. I thank you for your time. I thank you for your attention, and thank you for being so a disciplined audience. I look forward to your questions and your comments. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much for Ebrahim Moosa. I really like that picture idea where people come and hang the dresses and jackets just so to help the ladies, the others. But it is also possible that someone who comes and start collecting this stuff, then sell it off and gain from that in the easy way. But the only way, it is only that human dignity, having that dignity that will prevent someone to make, to manipulate, to write on other people's needs for their own personal interests. So that is very powerful. I'm not sure whether we can do that here. Probably out there in Moiz, Muhajirin, we have can be in this extra class. But thank you very much again. Now this, as we engage in this discussion, reminds me of a Chilean cognitive biologist, Maturana, once said that it is only through reflection that we change history. And human beings are reflective beings. We are reflective beings engaged in a community of conversation, as Paul Graham has mentioned earlier. So we are all here human beings, alhamdulillah, we are reflective beings. Now, this is a time for us to engage in a conversation. And let me open the floor for we've got mics going along, so you can ask questions. Please help identify yourself, so just so that we'll be able to probably make that connection. Yeah, please. Anyone to begin? Yeah, I've got one hand there. Can I collect three questions and take that in one? So I've got one, yes, please, sir. Can you pass
Michael
to
Woodward, Arizona State University in the U.S. I'm really taken with what you said about dignity and the importance of stressing that. But my question here is that I think speaking here to this audience tonight is rather much like what some American clergy would call preaching to the choir. What would your suggestions be for strategies for carrying this message forward to the general Muslim population, the type of people who don't have a great deal of either religious or secular education?
Excellent. That's a good question. You always engage in people who are already. So how then do you reach out to the others? Can I collect another question? Another two.
Hi. Hi, I'm Mohammed Halim, and I'm from Junior College here. My question is, if human dignity is... I don't think I have to repeat my name. Anyway, my question is, if human dignity is the central value of ethics in Islam, then why is it that it seems that we have differed so far from our fitrah, our natural disposition as ethical human beings? I mean, if you say that this is the central message, which I fully agree, but why is it that, you know, we don't seem to be coming anywhere near that, and in fact we have gone far from that, we've differed so much, you know, that ISIS and all that exists? Thank you.
Thank you. Any question related to the idea of human dignity? I'm happy that this word is being repeated. Yeah? I can't see the hand. Oh, yes.
At the start of the talk, you mentioned that Sharia is not the law and it's only applicable to law when it comes to certain issues like the capital punishment. So would you like to share more about capital punishment and the hudud?
Okay. I know you have
talked
to respond to those two questions.
Thank you very much, Professor Woodward. Thank you for your presence. I guess it's the choir that I have to take the message to those who are not part of the choir. So at least we need a choir, we need an army to take this message through. One person cannot do so. So efficiency requires that the choir picks up this message and takes it seriously. But I think more importantly, I think the question you're asking is that, you know, how does one take this to the next level? How does one? That's my advocacy. I believe that if communities like people in Singapore, but other communities begin to make this as part of their day-to-day operational and as part of their narrative, then you will become an exemplar to other communities. And in that way, it will catch on. Now, it connects to the Muhammad Amin's question about, you know, if human dignity you know, is so important, and he seemed to agree, but he said, why have we deviated from our God-given, you know, orientation, our fitrah? Well, variety of reasons, certain forms of socialization, but also I think that in the kind of formation of Islamic religious teachings, both the theology and the interpretation of the ethics, religious scholars have been oblivious to this. Plus also the notion of what is human dignity changes over time. So for instance, in the medieval world, they thought of slavery and patriarchy and a certain kind of organization of a hierarchical way to be perfectly normal and dignified. The question is that we have now moved into terrains where the knowledge space has altered our understanding of self and other and our world, that we can no longer subscribe to a hierarchical understanding of human beings, of, you know, of free people and slaves and women and that kind of hierarchy, but we now think about things in a kind of a egalitarian fashion. We think about the other as an extension of the self. in the pre-modern world, the other was deeply other. So a whole variety of shifts have taken place in the world in which we are living. That means the meaning of human dignity and manifestation of human dignity also differs. So for instance, I can give you an example, for instance, of an 11th century scholar who talks about al-insanu mukarramun walau kana kafiran, Ibn Humam, in a classical textbook. A human being has dignity even if that person is a non-believer, right? Not a believer. Then, two lines after that statement, he comes across a question that in a world in which there is a war between the Islamic Empire and the adversary, and that's the Darul Harb, right? Darul Iman, Darul Islam, Darul Harb. If a prisoner of war in the Darul Harb converts to Islam, does that person get freedom? And he says no, because you are a prisoner of war. Converting to Islam doesn't, your prisoner of war can, you know, has a particular status. They can either be enslaved, they can either be ransomed, or they can be freed, or if they are danger, they get executed. That's under the classical law. Then he tries very hard to explain that even that a human being, that slave now, this enslaved person, who became a Muslim but he can't be freed given the rules of war, he says that the human dignity is attached to his the nafs haywaniya, to his a certain element of his soul. It is attached to that. In other words, he goes through a whole lot of thinking to still justify that even a slave has human dignity. Of course, in his world, he couldn't understand how, for us, you know, slavery would be antithetical to human dignity in our world. But in his world, slavery worked with his notion of human dignity. So human dignity undergoes change. And the big problem Muslim thinking has in all its fiqh and sharia thinking has been precisely how to implement the idea of human dignity under changed circumstances. And what does it mean? What does it mean? That's the crucial thing. And that's also to Professor Woodward's question is that, you know, how does this happen? It has to be something that the Muslim religious scholars at least take seriously, and if they internalize it, then this message can spread. So it works in concentric circles of people where consensus building takes place. And consensus building is a difficult thing. It also comes with education. You know, 100 years ago, talking about women's dignity and women's autonomy was a very difficult conversation. To talk about women being educated outside the public space, outside the domestic sphere in Muslim society was seen as heresy when Qasim Amin and other people wrote those stuff. So these things take time. Today we think it natural that a woman should be educated outside the domestic sphere. At a public school, at a university, at a college. It's almost natural, we don't think about it. But 150 years, this was unthinkable. It was unthinkable in Muslim majority societies. To come to the question of the lady in front about capital punishment, hudud. My view, hudud and these kind of capital punishments are part of a template of 7th century Arabia, of certain kind of customary practices that the Quran also included as part of its teaching. So about 500 Quranic verses deal with rules and regulations. Those rules and regulations are very, very custom, time specific. If you look at in the history of Islam, while these rules were implemented or held on the law books as a deterrent, the application of this is being extremely difficult. I've yet to come across, for instance, readings, and there might still be, I have not come across that, where someone writes, today 20 people's hands were chopped off in Baghdad because they were the thieves of prophet. Or the application of the hudud for, sexual offenses, very difficult to prove. Only if a person is crazy enough to confess, and the tradition tells you do not confess, rather repent, that's what the tradition teaches you, very difficult to implement. So obviously, historically, it did play the role of a deterrent. But oftentimes, in today's world, Muslims want to show that they are Muslim on steroids, or they are, you know, super Muslims, the first thing they do is to talk about the hudud. And oftentimes they want to chop off the hands of poor people who are hungry, whose hands should never be cut off, in places like Nigeria and Zamfara State and other places. I don't know what happens in your region. But they cut off the hands of the poor people. But those who steal from the state coffers, their hands are never cut off. So there is a wrong application of even that good intention. But these issues are questions of history and time. All of them are not always enforceable. All of them are not really meant to be enforced. They serve as deterrents. And I think, you know, Muslims who are brave enough, like Tariq Ramadan and others have talked about, that some of these hudud penalties have to be suspended. He got into a lot of trouble by Muslim Orthodox clerics. My research has shown that a very, very prominent 18th century Indian thinker by the name of Shawaliullah, in a long conversation that I can't go into right now, he talks about, you know, he says, the early communities, they subscribe to these rules because these rules work for them. It's part of the culture, it's part of the history, it's part of the practice. But the later communities, they only follow these rules because they want to belong to this order. But therefore, you must go easy in implementing the shi'ar, that is, those symbols and those emblems of Islam, and also must go easy and not be so harsh in implementing the hudud. He writes that in his book, Hujjatullah al-Baligha. So people like him has already meditated about these issues, put it in a very, very subtle ways in some of those books, and that requires further reflection on Muslim communities. But hudud is certainly not the number one issue. Today, in terms of human dignity, chopping off someone's hand, bodily punishment, would not be something that we will be advocating when we take human dignity seriously. So notions of human dignity over time have changed. Bodily infliction, bodily punishment is not something that is compatible to our understanding of human dignity, and that certainly will not be one of the things on my agenda.
If I can just follow up on that, because as we speak about human dignity, we're also speaking about traditions and how do we deal with our traditions. We can agree with you in terms of human dignity, therefore hudud may not be applicable today, but the text is there. It is in our Quran. It is our tradition. So how do we deal with it?
Well, you see, I mean, one of the things that we know also is that every verse in the Quran is not actionable. That has never been. Only super ignorant Salafis understand the Quran in that way. Muslims historically and the canonical tradition never understand every verse of the Quran to be actionable. And especially the Ahkam verses. Ahkam verses are 500 verses. There are verses in the Quran that says that, you know, that someone, you know, write down, O believers, that if you engage in a credit transaction, write it down. It's a commandment, write it down. No Muslim jurist would say that if you had an oral agreement on a credit transaction, that is not legal, not legitimate. So there's a very complicated hermeneutic. Now clearly, no medieval scholar has said that hudud is not applicable. No medieval scholar has said that. And it'll be wrong of me to even say that. What I'm saying is that some of these practices, so for instance, let's think about the question of women's testimony. The Quran talks about women's testimony, that two women's testimony equal to that of one man. And Muslim jurists today have made a lot of effort to explain that even that statement was only for commercial transactions. So immediately that verse becomes specified that the criteria for woman's testimony is about qualification. Who is qualified again? So why can't we apply our minds on the hudud, with also Quranic verses and all kind of other stuff, intelligently and in the light of human dignity? That is what is required. I will not be the first one to have said that. And if I know this is a hot potato, people get extremely upset and say you're denying the nas of the Quran. It's not the denial of the nas of the Quran, it's the understanding of the nas of the Quran. So you have to understand the nas of the Quran in the light of other verses of the Quran, and now this nas means something different. So the nas talks about the bad, so it doesn't mean that you have to become amoral, that you must become sexually licentious on the hudud, that you must encourage stealing. There are other ways to punish people who are stealing. There are other ways to discipline people who engage in, you know, acts of public immorality. That's what these hudud laws are about, to regulate public immorality. It's not that Sharia and God takes pleasure out of beating people to pulp or to executing people. That is not Islam's teachings. These are detailed teachings, and it's time that we get onto that page and understand that what it means, that it doesn't mean that to move away from the values that God has advocated, that those values still remain, but the application of that changes over time and how we do that. So today, for instance, when people steal, we imprison them, or we ask them to refund the people from whom they are taken, and all kinds of various ways that we deal in our criminal justice system. So hudud are even applicable in places like Singapore, but in a different way, through laws. You've created certain boundaries. Your laws are your hudud. These are the had, these are the criteria. When you trespass, or in America we have hudud, but we don't call it hudud, we call it laws. Congress legislation. You trespass certain rules and regulations, then you're in trouble, and you're in violation. Now, Muslims have made the only meaning of Islam to be hudud, or some Muslims rather. It's time to unlearn that, and learn that the real meaning of Islam is the ethical.
Thank you very much. Can I invite other for the questions? Yes, I see one in the sister two and the third here. Oh, yeah. So can you pass the mic for me?
Hi. So thank you for sharing. I'm Mohammed Khairila, also from the Junior College in Singapore. So you just mentioned that we need to unlearn hudud and learn about the true ethics of humanity. So I'm just a bit curious. My question is a bit more specific. What specific reforms would you advocate about the Islamic education system and education systems in general to learn about human dignity and the like? Thank you.
Thank you, Mohammed. Can you pass the mic to the sister? I mean, let's go ahead, explore beyond just simply analyzing the situation, complaining of the situation. How you can think of ways, the Prophet has suggested certain remedies. Probably it's good to also consider ways, how do we go up from this situation rather than just simply lamenting and complaining of the situation. Yes, sister, please.
Right, thank you. You mentioned that Sharia law is like updating telephone books, right? So how do we decide which fragments of the Sharia law is relevant in today's world? Given we as individuals, you know, we go through different experiences and have different perspectives of what's ethical and what's not.
Thank you very much. We've got here.
Okay, I want to ask a question. Why for many years, I'm turned from the public. For many years, why the Arab world, the Muslim world or OIC never speak up, no, take up real action? The good news is the Quran is the word of wisdom from God, scientific fact. The bad news, 99 translation of the Quran is condemnation and got error. You can log into a smartphone, open Burhan.com, burhan.com. Even Yusuf Ali also translate wrongly. The worst translation is from the Middle East, Saudi Arabia. What I noticed, Muslims from the early century, after Prophet Muhammad passed away, what they follow is not true Islam. They are following Wahhabi Islam. The true and falsehood mixed together. In chapter Al-Baqarah, chapter 2, verse 40, God says, do not mix the true and falsehood together. And chapter 2, verse 2, God said this is the only book, the top one book only. And chapter 25, verse 33, God said, whatever argument you come up with, you give you the best explanation. And the Quran will explain by itself. We don't need any other book to explain. Chapter 75, verse 16.
Can I understand the question, sir?
So why the Muslim world never take action against the wrong translation? The worst translation. I say the translation from the Saudi Arabia was no. They promote terrorism.
Okay.
You see, in chapter 2, verse 2, they put a bracket there, they mentioned sect. And they put a comment, if you don't go for Friday prayer, you command the beaver to burn the house, and we put words into Prophet or not now. It don't make sense at all.
Okay, I got your point. Thank you.
And last one, in chapter 9, verse 97, God said that Arab are the worst in this disbelief, likely to ignore the word of God. They changed the word Arabu to normal and Benoit to mislead the prophet.
Okay, thank you very much.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you very much. Let me just take the discussion, then I'll get back to you. Yeah. Probably want to comment on specific recommendations of Islamic education and education as a whole. So how then we get out of this situation?
Thank you. I think the speaker, the questioner himself, might have better ideas than I have. So I'm going to be thinking about this already. So I don't claim to have all the ways to answer that. A little bit that I think that, you know, how educational reforms. I think one of the first pieces of educational reform, you know, I've had to spend a lot of time through going through my traditional education in India's traditional madrasas. I've had to do a lot of experimenting in order to get what I wanted. So I have some experience in that, but you know, my experience cannot be the sum total of, you know, what should be done. But one of the key things is that I've learned is that one should be learning how to question, to ask a question. How to ask questions. One of the things in which humanities education helps you, why I'm such a strong believer in the humanities education, as one of the ways, but also social science and science, that you must have a sound humanities education to get it. Because humanities education helps you to think through. Scientific questions, mathematics, helps you to think about things in a kind of a beautiful way, to solve problems. It's a problem-solving way. But how to ask questions outside the box? The things that, you know, Leonardo did, or, you know, the kind of ways in which, you know, important thinkers like, you know, Ibn Hazm asked questions, a Muslim jurist who also wrote literature, or a philosopher like Ibn Sina and Al-Ghazali. So what it requires is a certain way of questioning and interrogation and asking questions. The other thing is that we need to think about the harvest of human experience that is contained of how we think emotively. And how we think emotively is captured in poetry, in literature, and in art. And we must bring that back, because that is the beauty of the tradition. So how are we going to do this reform? I would say that for most, I spend a lot of time thinking about how Muslim clerics should be educated. So let me say that. I would say that if I have to go my education all over again, at age 17 or 18, I was extremely enthusiastic. And I wanted to know what is the true Islam. And I was told that true Islam, well, I thought for myself, true Islam is in the hands of very pious and very traditional scholars. If I get a chance all over again, I would want to study with those scholars again, but with a difference. I would want to have a four-year foundational education in Arabic literature, in humanities and social sciences, so I can have a foundation to then interpret, because I spent 6 years in India experimenting with all kinds of things. I had to learn a lot of things and unlearn a lot of things in my life. So therefore, we need to have educational systems in which we do not reinvent the wheel and work from a common base. I mean, I experimented with Islamism. I can even say it, you know, the Afghan war just began. If I wasn't so critical and skeptical in my own way, I could have ended up being a Mujahideen in fighting the Soviets if I lost my head. And so it is the question about how one gets carried away, and an educational system must give you certain capacities to think. And it doesn't allow you to think that. So for instance, a couple of days ago, in the mosque where I am, in Ramadan, the guy leading the prayer, the witr prayer, at the end of Taraweeh, which is an additional prayer, there's always a very powerful supplication people make. This guy is praying for the destruction of Bashar al-Assad, okay? So he's now calling for the destruction of Bashar al-Assad. Then he's calling for the help to the Mujahideen in Syria. And I want to know from him, who exactly are the Mujahideen in Syria? But you see, the emotional, people become so emotive because, I mean, in Syria, every group is worse than the other. So I want to know who's the Mujahideen. I'm not saying Bashar Assad is a good guy, but one must be careful of what you are saying so emotively. So one can be carried away by emotive power without thinking. And so I would say a foundational education means the humanities, the Islamic humanities. Muslims, clerics must know about Ibn Khaldun, they must know Ibn Sina, they must know about, they know about Durkheim, they need to know about Weber, they need to know how a modern economy functions. You don't have to become an expert in economics, just know how the rudimentary elements of economics. Then you understand how values are created, how values change through economic transformations, how all these things happen. That's what I think a clerics education should be. What that of a 6-year-old should be, I leave it to experts who like Dr. Hanan and others who know how to craft that. But I would say they can find innovative ways to bring those messages in. But there are a lot of things in the tradition that are antithetical to human dignity. And we need to vet those things. And we need to check those things. And those things can be done in a very, very easy way. Which fragments to share and use to the question is precisely that. Look, this might not be the job of every layperson, but at least a layperson should use their critical intelligence when the imam is giving a speech, or someone sitting next to you, sitting and talking to you about world affairs or Muslim affairs, and tells you the most ridiculous stories, the ridiculous accounts, dehumanizing other people. You must be able to have the moral strength to say, you're talking absolutely nonsense. I'm going to leave this meeting right now because you're talking about crazy things and I don't want to be part of this. And it might have to be the end of friendship. But you have to take a stance. The problem why things do not change is because we want to be so nice, we are not prepared to take a position. You have to take a position on some things that talks about the dehumanization of other people. For instance, you know that in the United States, if you use the N-word about people, you'll immediately be chastised. You cannot use a racial epithet, right? We have considered that to be immoral to use that. Why can't it be immoral when we talk about, you know, talking about world events in conspiratorial ways and say X and Y is to blame? It is demeaning, it is dehumanizing. It is not a joke. So I'm not talking about the high things. The work that needs to be done about the fragments of the Sharia, which one to use, which one, that's work of experts. Scholars can do that. And good scholars can do the deliverables. Communities can also be part of that conversation. You can broaden the conversation. In South Africa, where we had and developed a democratic order, when we decided about questions about the rights and obligations of religious communities, it was both the work of experts and also conversations that feedback from communities. Our constitution was written in that way. Experts wrote the constitution, but then it went to the ground and people talked about it and debated it and gave it feedback. So who's going to do what? We can assign, we can have money and jobs for people to do this kind of work. That isn't that. You don't have to be a rocket scientist for that. The question is, how do we implement those things, and how do we use the resources available in our community to realize that? But first you must have the resolution to do that. But if we are worried which fragments are going to go in and out, if beforehand, we're never going to go on. So think about the problem itself. If it's a genuine problem, sign on to it, get down to work. Then you'll know which fragments go in, which go out. But if you are doubtful whether this project in itself is valuable, then obviously it's not a project for you. And then somebody else's task. I do advocate it to be a project that you need to think through the past tradition, what part of it is usable and what's no longer usable. I gave you an example of how a scholar talks about and thinks about that a person who is not of the Muslim faith also has human dignity, how he struggles. It shows you a map that people, even in the age of slavery, thought about human dignity. In that way, these becomes the kind of threads by which you craft a new kind of narrative. And it's there where we need to go because the Muslim discursive tradition is extremely rich. The problem with Muslims today is that we are completely ignorant of our past. There's been kind of systematic unlearning. And there's also something called learned ignorance. So people who know little think they know everything. And that's part of a problem. Learning brings about humility. And unfortunately, in some areas of the world, when people go and study, once they finish with a 4 or 6 year degree, they think they've learned everything. That's only the beginning of learning. It's only the beginning of questioning. And so part of the problem is that we need to, it should be lifelong learning for everybody, for clerics as well as lay people, as well as for specialists, and that's where the answer lies. I think the question that the gentleman raised about the various translations of the Quran, translations are very different, people have different ways of understanding the Quran and how they interpret it, and you know, each one of these translations will be worthy for some people and not worthy for other people. I think one of the things that we also, a part of the problem is that I've just read a very good article in the in Foreign Affairs today by Gregory Gauss III wrote a fantastic article about the politics of Saudi Arabia. Oftentimes, all the problems are laid at the door of Saudi Arabia and Wahhabism. That is the birthplace of Wahhabism, but Wahhabism has now gone global. Some part of Wahhabism Saudi Arabia doesn't even have control about, and is now in the hands of all kinds of agents. So I think we need to be careful of how we blame Wahhabism for every problem in the world. That is another part. That is not intelligent diagnosis. That is clearly not that intelligent diagnosis. There are bad elements in Saudi Arabia, extremist groups there, but Saudi Arabia today faces a plague of their own Wahhabis who want to kill them. Wahhabis want to kill Wahhabis. So go and figure that one out, okay?
Okay, we've got just 5 minutes. Let me take one last round. Arif, and just another brother here. Yeah, and then the third one, please. Anyone? Okay, so this will be the last three. Yes? Okay. I'll give you but just a quick and straight one, yeah?
Assalamu alaikum. My name is Imran. I actually just got into RSIS. I'm doing Asian studies. Before this, I'm a sociologist. And I'm also studying Arabic and traditional Islamic studies. So I'm really interested in this talk. And my question is regarding Islamic ethics in a secular society, in a modern secular society. Isn't there a kind of limit to how far Islamic ethics can be applicable or supported by the establishment, given that the environment of secularism, it promotes more of a materialistic outlook? So I have in mind issues like the LGBT issue. So going with Islamic ethics, we are more like essentialists on the nature of men and women. And I think, like, for example, our Prime Minister has stated like that we are not ready to accept LGBT. So the agenda is clear that there's a difference. Like, we are, on the Islamic side, we are more of this is wrong, but we respect you for your beliefs kind of thing. And then on the secular side, it's like, well, you're free to believe what you want to do. So how do we address this difference?
Thank you. Can we pass the mic to Anand?
My name is Shafiq. I'm a sociology undergraduate from a local university. You talked about Habermas and the private sphere and how the discussions have to be independent of the state. But today we have, an entanglement of civil societies, NGOs, who are also part of the state. They are part of the state, but yet not of the state. And also sometimes all these conversations, they revolve around state actors as well. So how do we get an independent discussion, but yet at the same time, involve members, an independent discussion that also involves the state, yet also it is not something that is directed by the state. So how do you evolve from that kind of thing? Yeah, thanks.
Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Irish Mal from the National University of Singapore. My question is really about the title that you've given us about the public sphere. And when you invoked Habermas, I wonder if there's any advice you could give to Muslims in Singapore, or more generally, about how to express themselves in the public sphere. Because increasingly, I think Muslims are being called upon to speak out, to speak about what's happening in the Muslim world in the public sphere. And are there guidelines that you would suggest for how that should be done?
Well, I think we need another hour here. These are interesting questions indeed, but I saw another hand, just the last question.
Yeah, thank you very much for the presentation. My name is Moosa, I'm a retiree. just out of curiosity, right? Islam is a religion of morality. But however, given the way it's going, it seems that it's being politicized. And how do you reconcile between, you know, the teaching of Islam and going to politics? And as what you have mentioned, there are many hands going to the public offer. So how is that being, you know, reconciled? Thank you.
Okay. The question that's raised about the issue of secularism and materialism and Islamic ethics and the environment of Islamic ethics is being advocated and so on. That's a genuine, I would treat that to be a genuine anxiety. And it's a genuine anxiety insofar as people feel committed that their values have something very, very specific and very, very unique and very, very different from that of the other. At some levels, on some values, those will be different. But there are several other values and there will be overlapping consensus between a secularist, a materialist, an atheist, a Hindu, a Buddhist, people of other religious tradition will all have a certain amount of agreement. So often, and even if sometimes the practices are even identical, the motivations come from different places, right? And so I would basically say that the questions of the ethical, for a believer and a devout and a Muslim, is not only about achieving the dividends in this world, but there are also dividends in the afterworld. There's a transcendent component to it. But it doesn't mean that you do short shrift of the work in this world and say, I'm waiting for my reward in the afterworld. You do have to excel in this world to get excellence in the other world. But the idea of the relationality to the afterworld is a very critical one. It's a very crucial one. And oftentimes we don't understand that if we fail in this world, it's not the end of the journey. Now some of these issues that you had raised about, you know, LGBTQ and those kind of issues, these are hot button issues for all religious communities. They're not easy solvable. We have long traditions and so on. But the minimal plea is, how do we deal humanely with individuals who belong to that community? You're not talking about legislation. You're talking about humanity. And that's what one of the big challenges. And the question here is that you know, it's not as if we've discovered LGBT communities in the 21st century. It's been part of humanity's legacy for a long time. So, you know, we might want to look at the historical archive to see how this has been dealt with and how various societies have dealt with it. But in answer to the last gentleman's question about the politicization and the question of the ethical and so on, I'll be remiss if I don't tell the story. There's a man called Sheikh Abdul Qadir al-Jazairi, Abdul Qadir of Algeria. He worked in Algeria in the 1830s. He was a Sufi sheikh, a religious leader, and a man who combated and fought the French, who occupied Algeria. When he lost the battle against the Algerians and they captured him, they arrested him. He made a deal with the Algerian, with the French, and the deal was that they would honor certain things. Instead, they broke the agreement, and they put him under abject conditions in a French prison. Now, this is a man of deep piety and religiosity, who also understood the political. And when he was arrested and caught, he said, "I was doing my best, but God wished something else for me." He didn't say to all his people that he left behind that each one of you must become a suicide bomber and destroy every Frenchman that you see in Algeria. There's a certain kind of understanding of the present and the attainment, what you can attain, and the rest you have to leave for another day, for another time, and for another power. But here's the interesting thing about Abdul Qadir al-Jazairi, that finally when the French then corrected on their promise, that they put him in exile in Damascus. In Damascus, there was an uprising against French occupation again. And in this village and this uprising, local Syrians were ready to slaughter, and many French persons got slaughtered in the mayhem and the uprising and the violence that took place. Abdul Qadir al-Jazairi and his family stood guard in a neighborhood where they saved 3,000 French lives. This is the ethical that Islam talks about, that you show compassion even to your most serious and your most violent enemies, that you show that you have to transcend, that you must go beyond your limits to show the humanity of the others. This is the page that every school book should have and talk about, and talking about Islamic humanity and Islamic dignity. And so the question is not about the struggle. The struggle that you're going to have to sort out how you're going to deal with LGBT communities. 20 years, 100 years, 50 years ago, we had the same kind of questions about, you know, the status of women in Islam. So long as you have a determination, you come to the answers. And the answers will be. So the question about the secular and the materialistic, oftentimes these become kind of obstacles to thinking rather than engaging in the thinking process itself. Of course, in Singapore, you're going to have varieties. And you are going to be competing with secular viewpoints and other viewpoints. Therefore, you need to have a better viewpoint in here to strengthen your viewpoint. And maybe at the end of the day, a secular and a materialist and a Buddhist and a Muslim viewpoint on some issue is going to be identical. And so what is the problem in that? Unless you think that there is a special kind of Islamic DNA in ethics that is going to be very different from other things, then we're talking in a very different ballgame. There might be some particularities and certain kind of boundaries that Islam has, but on many issues, the good is very common. There we're talking about the common good. So I think that anxiety should not be there. The guidelines about how to talk about in the public sphere. I think to talk about in a public sphere, one has to be honest about oneself and the communities we're talking about. One must also talk about the causes on the mega level. But there's also a time when you invoke the mega thing and when you don't invoke it. So for instance, if after 9/11, I get up and speak to an American audience and say, of course 9/11 happened because America has done all these things, all these wrong things, I'm not going to be effective in my messaging, even though the analysis of what might have caused these terrorists to arise, the material causes, but nothing justifies killing 3,000 people because someone else had done something in Afghanistan or oppressed Palestinians in another place or supported Israel. Nothing justifies killing 3,000 people. So the mega questions are always in the background, but there are sometimes when you have to articulate it, sometimes you don't articulate it. But honesty is the important thing, and also talk truth to power when one's engaging in public, in public discourse and engaging in the public sphere. One must keep trust with your audiences too, and sometimes one must give your own audience the bad news. And the bad news is not always palatable. And one of the big problems with Muslims engage in public sphere activism, they want to keep their audiences happy. And they don't want to give bad news because they want to have, you know, so many thousand people on Facebook, they want to have so many Twitter followers and so on. I am having stand-up arguments with colleagues in the UK and in France when I'm saying you are not giving a very critical analysis of the internal problems of Muslim communities. Speak about these internal problems very openly and publicly. The answer is, well, you know, if we speak about these things openly, the Islamophobes are going to latch onto it. Well, let them latch onto it. At least they're going to latch onto the right issues and not accuse you that you want to try to convert the whole of France to Islam or all this kind of ludicrous thing that they talk about. So I think that we're having very poor analysis, and therefore it requires a certain kind of commitment, a certain kind of honesty, and a certain kind of conviction to operate in the public sphere. Otherwise, you know, we're just writing beautiful words and no one learns anything from what we are saying. So these will be kind of few things that come to mind. We can have a conversation later on. And on the politicization, unfortunately, when I started with governance, if governance is not good, then religion is going to do all kinds of things that they're not supposed to do. So religion has to do the political, religion has to do the economic, and so on. So you need to have societies that the various sectors of societies must fulfill its function. Otherwise, you're going to put religion is going to be now the place where people begin to express their victimhood. and many segments of Muslim societies in different parts of the world have become professional victims. Victimhood has now become the kind of in game. And it doesn't have to be like that. There are genuine victims, but it seems that people who are living in very plush conditions, who have big bank balances, they also become victims. And that is only strategic victimhood, right? That is only because they don't want to engage in a difficult task of reforming the societies, becoming unpopular, talking the truth, and doing the right thing for their communities. I thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you very much. I know that Shafiq's question has not been answered. I will record this. I will get Hannah to organize something because that is a very important question. We talk about state independent views, and then in the nature of any conversation, there must be certain disorder, but yet we want an orderly disorder. Right? So, in our discourse about public sphere and so on and so forth, but never mind, we will not be able to answer that. But I'll make sure that my team will include that, as well as the question that raised by Anna Pato is very important. We cannot just ask for airtime to express our views, but we must also know how to express these views. Yeah, just to ensure that that can be resolved. So my guys will take note of this. We will include this in our future events, and we will invite you, inshallah. Yeah, we will have you in the list. Anna, please make sure that Shafiq's question will be recorded, and make sure you invite him. Yeah? So, now, I must thank you to the bottom of my heart, Ibrahim Moosa. He has been talking since Monday until tonight, 10, and he has been talking to different sectors of the community, media, public officers, asatiza, students. So let him have a good break. He needs that with the wife, inshallah. And please join me in thanking Prophet Ibrahim Moosa again for his excellent.
Right. Thank you, Dr. Hanan and Professor Moosa. It was indeed an enlightening talk and a refreshing discussion. Maybe we all benefit from that action and exchange of ideas. One thing which I always remember is how to ask questions and the idea of human dignity. Okay, now I request both of you to remain on stage because now it is time for me to invite Deputy Chief Executive of Muis and Dean of Muis Academy, Dr. Al-Rafi Ahmed, as well as the Executive Deputy Chairman of the S. Rajaratnam School of International Studies, Ambassador Ong Keng Yong, to present a token of appreciation for our distinguished speaker. So can you please welcome them on stage? Thank you, Ambassador Ong Keng Yong and Dr. Al-Wakri. And of course, our speaker, Professor Ibrahim Moosa. Could you please join me in thanking our speaker, Professor Ibrahim Moosa, for the enlightening lecture? Thank you. Now, before we end, I'm just going to highlight a few things that are happening actually for RSIS. The next RSIS seminar within the seminar series on Muslim societies in Asia will be next week on the 28th of July with the renowned political scientist of the Middle East, Dr. Daniel Hashimi. He will be discussing the role of Islam in the transition to democracy. For more information, you can subscribe to the newsletter on the RSIS website. Now, of course, we've come to the end of our program. May you leave today's event feeling enlightened for a better grasp of the role of Islam and other faith traditions in the shaping of the common good, and that will benefit all of humanity. Thank you, distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, for being part of this event. May we meet again in the near future. I wish you good night and have a pleasant journey home. Thank you.